Well, Peter Schiff, chairman of Schiff Gold, located at schiffgold.com, author of several bestsellers. Welcome back to the show, Peter Schiff.
Thanks for having me back on.
Let's begin today with the crude oil meltdown. You know, the impact it's had on the global economy already starting to show signs in the last couple of months or so. West Texas Intermediate crude has lost nearly 50%, primarily on dollar strength and economic weakness in China and the EU. Something similar occurred in 2008. It coincided with the equities meltdown. Do you see anything similar on the horizon?
Well, you know, I think a lot of markets have been influenced by cheap money, the Federal Reserve. Oil prices are one of them. I mean, oil prices went up to $150 a barrel in 2008 because of the easy money policies that fueled the housing bubble. And they went up about to maybe $115 a barrel after they collapsed down to $32 a barrel in 2008. And I think a lot of the price increases is due to inflation. It's due to central banks creating money. Well, the markets are preparing for the Fed to stop creating money. In fact, the Federal Reserve has been bluffing that not only will it end QE, but it will raise interest rates and shrink its balance sheet, which is like destroying money, taking money out of circulation, shrinking the money supply. That's what the Fed has been pretending it can do. And I think that has effects as people start to price that in. And it just so happens that maybe the first market to feel the pain is the oil market. But if the Federal Reserve continues on this pretense, it'll be a lot of markets, like the stock markets and the real estate markets. And in fact, the U.S. economy will be back in recession if the Fed removes all the monetary props, which is why I don't believe that they're going to do it. I mean, they just came out today with a statement, and it's all a bunch of nonsense because they know they have no intention of ever raising rates.
But according to the Federal Reserve Bank of Cleveland, as of this month, December 2014, their balance sheet has never gone down. In fact, it's approaching $4.5 trillion. That's on track for $5 trillion. Now, here's the question. How can the dollar remain so strong when the currency is debased to such a degree? Is it merely the least toxic currency on the block?
Well, it's because, A, yes, other central banks are debasing their currencies too, but people have confidence that the actions of the Fed will be reversed. Janet Yellen has promised to reduce the balance sheet down below a trillion by the end of the decade. Now, of course, nobody has bothered to consider that that's not even possible, that there's no way that the Fed could do that because there's no one who would buy those bonds. The Fed can't get rid of $3.5 trillion worth of treasuries and mortgages. There's no buyers. But people just don't bother to connect the dots. But I think when they do, you know, look today, the Fed came out when they tweaked this statement, you know, the considerable period. So they came out and they said, okay, we'll be patient. But then they said, but patient means the exact same thing as considerable period. Well, then what's the point of changing the words? I mean, if you're going to go out and say that the meaning hasn't changed, then why change the words? I mean, that's all they can do. But the one thing they can't do is actually raise rates. So they're just trying to, you know, put some kind of spin on it. They're trying to pretend that they're going to do it without actually doing it.
Jim Rickards is calling for $3,000 gold, $100 silver. Don't expect these numbers overnight. He says the next bull market in precious metals, though, could leave many investors flat-footed, scratching their heads, wondering what's going on, that conditions could shift overnight. It's so abrupt, many people miss the opportunity altogether.
I would kind of agree that I think when this market really turns, it's going to do it, you know, with a vengeance. It's going to be in a way that if you're not already in the market, you're not getting in. And if you're short, you're just going to be decimated. I mean, I could see the market, the gold market, moving up over $100 in a single day, maybe $200 or $300. I mean, I think that could happen because I think when enough people come to the correct conclusion, maybe the Fed announces QE3 or tips its hat that it's losing its confidence in the recovery and it is actually contemplating more quantitative easing. Nobody expects that. Everybody is positioned for the opposite of that. And I think when you get a scramble back into gold, particularly from the shorts who want to cover and new longs who want to enter, there is no supply to meet that demand, and the price would have to skyrocket.
Most people, when they hear of market manipulation, in the past it conjured up images of traders on the wrong side of the market, trying to talk the market back in line with their expectations. But more recently, the number of well-documented cases of manipulation, I think these scandals are just piling up. Look, we've got the LIBOR rate-fixing scandal. More recently, there's been currency rigging allegations. These are enormous markets. To give some perspective, the Forex trades over $3 trillion a day. That makes the stock and the bond markets look small in comparison. And silver and gold, you know, drops in the bucket. Do you take any comfort in the fact that these markets are being downward manipulated, gold and silver? And what could that mean going forward?
Well, again, I don't know that it's necessarily manipulation, but it's the major players all acting in unison based on the same themes and the same misconceptions. I mean, think about all the people that piled into dot-com stocks in the 1990s. I mean, the stocks weren't being manipulated, but the prices were rising based on the decisions that people were making at that time. And it was only, the ultimate fundamentals reasserting themselves as, you know, companies started losing money and defaulting on their obligations, that and when, you know, new companies couldn't come to market because that the bubble burst. And, you know, the same thing happened in housing and in the mortgage market. It wasn't a conspiracy or a manipulation. It was just a bunch of decisions made by a lot of people with a lot of borrowed money. And so I think the same people that made the decisions to buy dot-coms and to buy mortgages, subprime mortgages, are shorting gold. I mean, they're convinced that that's the thing to do, just like they were convinced that the dot-coms were the things to do. But once again, they're going to be spectacularly wrong. And I think the losses that they're going to suffer are going to be substantial.
According to one media source, it would take less than $2 billion to corner the COMEX, just a fraction of the cost of even one Dow Jones component. Do you see a time where the major precious metals exchanges have difficulty delivering any precious metal?
Oh, yeah. I mean, certainly. And that's what, you know, you think about the things that if Putin was really thinking and he's concerned about the situation with the ruble, they've got enormous foreign reserves. If they simply use some of those foreign reserves to buy gold and silver futures, or maybe gold futures because it's easier for delivery, if they just went in there and bought a bunch of gold futures and then asked for delivery, that would be enough to skyrocket the price of gold, which then they would own even more gold. But I think the collapse of the dollar that would result from the skyrocketing price of gold would also be bullish for the ruble.
I'd like to talk about a major dislocation that's being reported by Martin Armstrong. According to some of his sources, any major buyer, any big player in the precious metals market is finding delivery virtually impossible for anything less than $600 over spot. Like, here's an example. Let's say the price of gold around $1,100, $1,200. Anything in tonnage could require $1,700, $1,800 or more, and the only place they can find sellers are in Asia. Can you translate this into everyday trader and investor lingo?
It means if you're looking for significant quantities of gold, they're just not to be had. That, you know, we're not experiencing that right now on the retail level because we don't have clients that are buying gold by the ton. You know, we're selling it by the ounce. And in that respect, we're not having a problem, at ship gold for people who want to buy, you know, 5-10 ounces of gold. But, you know, if you have major players who are looking to move significant amounts of fiat into gold and they're having a problem locating the physical, that really shows you how tight the supply is. And, you know, what I would suggest some of those entities do, rather than paying such a big premium to the spot price, just go buy some futures contracts and take delivery because it's a lot cheaper there. You know, that's assuming, of course, the counterparty is able to affect delivery. Of course, if you can't, that means the exchanges go bankrupt and the price of gold really goes up.
Exactly. I'd also like your thoughts on real estate. You know, we've seen quite a knockback here in recent weeks. It looks like the real estate market, for the most part, has been stuck for about a year or two, treading water. Some of my guests in the industry are talking about this market's going to roll over circa 2008 as the hedge funds and the large institutions start to clear these massive inventories.
I mean, look, in the purchase application, were released today. The weekly applications down 7%. We're about 5% below the levels we were at a year ago in purchase mortgages. Even though rates are lower than they were a year ago, gasoline prices are a lot lower, so that might free up some consumer spending. And credit standards have been loosened. In fact, now Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac are putting U.S. taxpayer guarantees on mortgages with 3% down payments. Yet despite that, you're not seeing a pickup in home buying. So to me, I think it's done. I think if you look at the price appreciation, year over year has been declining, you know, all year. And I think it's not going to be too long before we start to see year over year declines in real estate prices. I think the only thing that's going to save the market temporarily is going to be QE4. But if the Fed can actually, you know, were to raise interest rates, I mean, that would put a nail in the real estate coffin. And I think you'd see another big drop in 2015, maybe as much as 15 or 20% nationally if the Fed actually raises rates.
So then do you see an opportunity for those who just haven't been able to purchase a home over the past few years? I mean, the typical investor has just had difficulty putting together enough money for a down payment despite the low levels that are required for down payments today.
Well, I wouldn't suggest real estate as an investment. So I think investors should be looking elsewhere for returns. But as a individual, as a consumption decision, right, do I want to own a house or do I want to rent, right? That's a decision that somebody could make. And if they decide that owning a house is a better decision for themselves or their family, you know, they can do it. You know, I mean, you know, depending on the market and the type of loan, I think inflation will wipe out a lot of the mortgage, but a lot of it depends on how much money you put down. But, you know, if you really are committed to a community and you've got kids and you want to stay someplace and you're pretty sure that you're not going to move and you want to own a home and you're prepared for all the incidental costs that come along with it, because home ownership is a lot more expensive than renting. But if you're prepared for the financial burden, certainly, you know, a 3.5% down payment isn't that much. If you can get a, you know, I think the rates now on 30-year fixed are in the threes again. They're about maybe 3.75. And so that's some pretty cheap money for a long period of time. Who knows what the dollar's going to be worth in 30 years? I joke with people, I think 30 years from now, when you send in your final mortgage payment, the number written on the stamp is going to be larger than the number written on your check.
You know, we've had listeners over the years, they said exactly what you just pointed out, where the stamp was worth more than the currency that they'd sent to them from the bank. So maybe we see something like that on the horizon.
I mean, I'm still hyperinflation as the worst case scenario. And hyperinflation still, I think, is something. Look, even Russia doesn't have hyperinflation now, although they have very high inflation. And I think that's certainly headed, you know, in our direction, despite the fact that today the government came out with a CPI number, which was the biggest drop in 6 years, you know, down 0.3, you know, mainly thanks to a drop in gasoline prices. But I don't believe these numbers anyway. I don't think they're very reflective of what's actually happening with consumer prices. So I think that prices are rising much faster than the government claims when they calculate these measures. But I do think that prices are going to rise to such a degree that it's going to be impossible to camouflage them under, you know, a contrived CPI. So I still believe that we're going to experience even official rates of inflation that will be higher than what was experienced in the 1970s. But, you know, whether it turns into hyperinflation is still, you know, open. You know, it depends on what we do, but it's certainly a possibility, and very few people are prepared for that possibility.
Speaking of hyperinflation, you know, we've seen unbelievably high levels here in the equities markets, U.S. equities markets, in the past few years. Some people are comparing it, you know, to the year 1999-2000 market zenith. Do you see anything like that on the horizon? Do you expect the equities markets to roll over, or are they just going to try to keep this train rolling forward?
Well, you know, I think there's a lot of headwinds with the U.S. market. The Fed, you know, helped generate a rally. It was already up before their statement, but, I mean, the statement to me is very dovish, you know, not as dovish as they could have been, but I think it's more dovish than people expected. And so I think that will lead some people to postpone when they think the first rate hike is coming, even though it's not coming at all. But that isn't apparent to most people yet. But I think there's going to be a lot of problems, you know, resistance to the U.S. market, you know, making significant new highs until the Fed comes clean, until we get, you know, more evidence. But, you know, it's a mixed bag, because if we get more evidence that the U.S. economy is weakening, which I think is forthcoming, I think there's been a lot of bad news and people have been ignoring it. But when it finally makes its way into the jobs numbers and the GDP numbers, which is where, you know, that's the only place anybody seems to care about bad news. But when it starts making its way in there, you know, will the markets react to the bad news on a slowing economy by going down because it maybe means that corporate earnings are not going to be there? Or will the market rally because they'll think that the Fed will be there?
Exactly. Well, you know, we've been interviewing right as the Fed statement was announced. And, of course, as you say, much more dovish than expected. I mean, they're noting they're going to be patient on the timing of the first interest rate hike since 2006.
The laughable part is they went out of their way to say that the new word patient is equivalent to the old word considerable period. In other words, they're changing the statement, but they're not really changing it. And everybody, you know, makes a big deal over these words.
And, you know, they're also watching the labor situation, because unemployment lowest levels, according to their figures, in years. But aren't they really concerned more about what's going on in China, Russia, and the EU? They're concerned of some contagion on both sides.
What has the Fed done in the past? You know, whenever we've had a crisis in Russia or in emerging markets, they've always responded by cutting rates to try to spare the U.S. From any of the pain. Well, how can they do that now? Rates are already at zero, and they promised to raise them. So what is the Fed going to do to the extent that the Russian problem spills over into a broader emerging market problem or affects the U.S. economy, which it clearly can? In fact, just oil prices being where they are, is it going to affect large segments of the U.S. economy? Because we've built up a pretty big oil industry over the years based on oil prices being $80 to $100 a barrel. And if oil is $40 a barrel or $50 a barrel, a lot of that investment is going to turn out to have been malinvestment. And a lot of these loans are going to go into default. A lot of the jobs that have been added in the energy sector, which are pretty much the best jobs we've been creating as far as pay, a lot of those jobs are going to go away. And so in and of itself, even though, you know, you have a benefit to the consumer of lower energy, it still could mean that we're going into a recession. You know, we had the same benefit in 2008 where oil prices went from 150 down to 30. That was an even bigger decline than we have now, so that was an even bigger boom for the consumer. But it didn't stop the Great Recession. It didn't stop the financial crisis. We had it anyway, you know.
So you might think that we could see something similar, because we saw that in 2008, as some folks have tried to point to it as a leading indicator, but it really was more of a coincidental indicator. We saw, you know, oil crashing 2008, and it seemed to coincide with the stock market implosion. So maybe not an implosion this time, but at least a serious pause in the advance then, you think?
I just continue to look at the foreign exchange markets, the precious metals markets, for any signs that anybody gets it. You know, that this is all, you know, that the Fed has no idea what they're doing, that they're just bluffing this whole thing, that, you know, we're on the verge of a worse financial crisis in 2008, that the Fed is in this box where it can never end its quantitative easing. So far, they're not giving me that signal. You know, I'm not seeing any meaningful breakout in gold prices higher, a reversal of the gains in the dollar. So right now, it's business as usual, completely complacent, and oblivious to what's going to happen. But I think, you know, when we get a sign that some people are figuring it out, it's going to move quickly. And I think that it's incumbent on investors, savers, to make sure that they have their ducks in a row in advance, that they've got the right portfolio, and tune out all the noise and forget about, you know, the money that people think they're making participating in the bubble, because it's all going to be lost when it bursts. And the people that walk away with the real returns are going to be the ones that never participated and had their correct portfolios all along.
How should investors be looking to participate in the precious metals? Do you like the physical?
Look, we like physical precious metals. We sell at Schiff Gold. We stay away from numismatics because of the notoriously high markups. And I'm trying to get into metals for the metal. I'm not trying to become a collector of rare objects. I mean, you know, numismatics are the same thing as buying, you know, stamps or baseball cards or, you know, works of art. They're collector's items. They're not necessarily monetary inflation hedges. Just because a numismatic is made of gold doesn't necessarily mean it's a gold investment. I mean, I can buy, you know, an antique coffee table. It doesn't mean I'm investing in wood, right? Just because that's what it's made of. So we go for physical precious metals. But I think for people who have more risk tolerance and want to really hit a home run, these gold stocks, mining companies, gold and silver mining companies, are the cheapest they've ever been. Many of them are priced for bankruptcy. So, you know, if gold just goes to 1,500, which is not a very big move from 1,200, you can see a lot of these stocks double, you know, on, you know, not even a 20% move in the price of gold. So there's a lot of upside there, and we can help you get the right gold stocks. We have a mutual fund that we manage of gold stocks people can buy. The Europe Pacific Gold Fund. So I think that's a great way for people to go. And, you know, by the way, most people, for all the negative headlines that gold's had all year long, gold's not even down this year. Gold's actually up a couple of percentage points. So it hasn't done that badly. There have been a lot of assets that you could have owned that did much worse than gold. In fact, you know, probably 80% of the world's stock markets, including almost all the major stock markets, underperformed substantially the price of gold in 2014. So, you know, gold hasn't done that bad. I mean, look at Bitcoin. You know, everybody was so excited about Bitcoin, you know, going into the year. Bitcoin prices are now at the low for the year. Last I looked, they're around $317 a coin. They were up over 800 when the year began. So you're talking about a 60% decline, more value than the ruble this year.
As we tried to point out here on the show, take a look at equities. The Dow is up not even, 100% since the year 2000? But if you'd held gold over the same period, you've made 3-4-fold on your investment. There's no comparison there.
You know, benchmark to 2000, because we had a big drop in the Dow, and certainly the NASDAQ. I mean, if you bought the NASDAQ in 2000, you're still down, right? The NASDAQ was above 5,000, and now it's 4,600. So, you know, you haven't even recouped your investment if you were just long an index fund of NASDAQ stocks. Yet you've still done very well in gold stocks, despite the fact that we've had, you know, a decline over the last few years from the record high. But yeah, the media, everybody likes to ignore the fact. And, you know, meanwhile, gold continues to protect people from inflation and currency depreciation. I mentioned that gold is only up a little bit this year in U.S. dollars, but you pick another currency. Look at the euro. Look at the Swiss franc, the Japanese yen, the Canadian dollar, the Australian dollar. You've got double-digit returns for gold in those currencies this year. And so gold's been a very good investment. You know, I mean, if you lived in Canada and you bought gold, you're doing better than if you bought the Canadian stock market. The same thing in Australia. Same thing in Germany. You know, if you even though the DAX maybe is up on the year, it hasn't done nearly as well as the price of gold. Most people would be better off, or were better off, buying gold than having bank accounts, government bonds, or stocks in their own country. So we're in a bad year.
I agree with you, and I'd only point out that even if we take the peak of 2000, gold is still such a outperformer, if you will. I mean, it's done so much better than equities. You don't have to go all in on gold, but I mean, you certainly want to have 20 to 30% of your portfolio in the precious metal. That way, if there is one of those rogue waves that hits the markets, just a few 100% increase in gold will offset virtually anything that happens to the rest of your portfolio. Peter Schiff, why don't you tell folks more about the services you provide, please?
Well, we provide brokerage services, asset management services. If people have money they'd like to invest, we help people invest around the world. You know, there are countries that are not economies as badly as the U.S. And I think that in an inflationary environment with 0% interest rates and lots of Fed money printing, you want to be weighted towards equities, just not U.S. equities. So to build a good portfolio, we do that for our clients at Euro Pacific Capital. People can go to the website, europac.net. They can call up a broker at 800-727-7922. For physical precious metals, they can go to Schiff Gold. I am, you know, always talking about the economy. I do a podcast now at schiffradio.com, the Peter Schiff Show. I do usually 3 or 4 different episodes per week. People can listen to them as I post them on my YouTube channel, or you can get them on iTunes, and, you know, different places that have podcasts. So I'm always out there giving information, and if you happen, I don't know if anybody listens from abroad, but my bank, Europe Pacific Bank, is open to non-U.S. citizens, and we have a full array of banking and brokerage services available, including my famous gold and silver backed debit card.
Peter Schiff, thanks for making time for us today.
Thanks for having me back on. Bye.